Good morning. Thank you so much for that very kind introduction. I can't tell you how excited I am to be here with you today. But in case you are wondering, I'm not that black guy who gave the commencement speech at Morehouse College last month. If you haven't heard, Robert Smith pledged $40 million in his speech to clear the educational debts of the nearly 400 students in the 2019 graduating class. Talk about the graduation speech to end all graduation speeches. The only thing that I can pledge, is that in comparison, you will feel extremely ripped off at the end of this speech. First, let me start by congratulating the class of 2019 on this wonderful achievement. I don't just imagine the blood, the sweat, the tears, and the immense amount of time that you've put into arriving at this point in your careers and in your lives. I actually experienced it firsthand as a graduate student here at MIT between 1987 and 1994. I can remember vividly the day that I completed and defended my dissertation and walking through the halls of MIT with a big grin on my face to get it signed by all the appropriate people, each of whom extended a hand to congratulate me. It was then that I realized with a smile that I had completed a major goal in my life and was eager to embrace what the future had in store for me. But when I was called last December and asked to speak at today's ceremony, my initial reaction was, is this man serious? And then as I spoke, I pivoted the phone about 180 degrees around my ear to place the mic above my head while whispering in a low voice, I wonder if he has me confused with someone else. And after it became clear that he didn't, I finally settled on, well, maybe no one else on their top 50 list of candidates was actually able to make it today. Surely, I thought, what is it that I, a pretty average guy from Southeast Texas, can offer graduates of such high caliber and high promise? Some of the most frequent topics that you'll hear in a graduation speech are opportunity, initiative, creativity, confidence, passion, and perseverance, among others. All are immensely important and have contributed to my own success. However, on a more personal note, I'd like to talk particularly about opportunity, which I believe has largely shaped the current professional and academic landscape with respect to race, ethnicity, and gender. Without opportunity, the other attributes don't really have the opportunity to stand out. So I grew up in Beaumont, a segregated city in Southeast Texas, nestled 25 miles from the Louisiana border and 25 miles from the Gulf of Mexico. I was raised by my grandmother, who assumed the role of a single parent at the age of 65 after raising 11 children of her own. My father was unknown at the time, and my mother, who had moved to the Bay Area of California, was not quite prepared for the constraints associated with child rearing. Many kids in my surroundings had similar stories, but I, unlike most others, was fortunate to have three uncles who lived in Beaumont, who served as mentors and role models, and who kept me off the streets. As an African-American kid growing up in Beaumont, or perhaps anywhere in Southeast Texas, a career in science was about as likely as winning the lottery, largely because there were virtually no role models in the field to encourage students to pursue science-based careers or to show that one could actually make a decent living as a scientist. No one really knew what a scientist did on a day-to-day basis except from what was shown occasionally on television. Moreover, it was not uncommon for some of our teachers to utter blanket statements like, black people can't do physics, which for some students was an affirmation of what they already believed. And so they would simply cross physicists off their list as a career to aspire to. Indeed, science was as segregated as the city of Beaumont itself. Outside of George Washington Carver, none of us knew much about any African-American scientists other than the handful of inventors who were perfunctorily showcased during Black History Month. Moreover, science and the African-American community have had a bit of a contentious relationship. At the turn of the century and during the early and mid-1900s, there were a number of truly great African-American scientists who struggled for recognition in their fields because of race. I was never aware of this issue until I came to MIT in 1986 as a participant in its very first Minority Summer Science Research Program, which began as an institutional effort to address the issue of underrepresentation in the sciences. And it was there that I listened to a talk by MIT professor Kenneth Manning, who had just published a prize-winning book a few years earlier on the life of Ernest Everett Just, titled Black Apollo of Science. And in that book, he described how this young African-American kid who was raised by a single mother in Charleston, South Carolina, rose to be a giant in the field of reproductive zoology, despite overt bigotry and a lack of opportunity. Because education for Black students down south was generally inferior, his mother sent him to Kimball Union Academy, an exclusive boarding school not far from Hanover, New Hampshire. There he graduated at the top of his class before moving on to Dartmouth University, where he won almost every prestigious academic award available and was the only magna cum laude or higher graduate in his class. Despite his stellar academic track record, Just, like many other African Americans at that time, was unable to find employment outside of teaching at a historically Black college. And the very best, like Just, ended up typically teaching at Howard University in Washington, D.C. And while there, he spent most of his summers conducting research at Woods Hole and was able to earn a PhD in zoology from the University of Chicago. He was a rising star in the area of fertilization and highly acclaimed and respected in Europe, but was unable to secure an academic appointment at a major institution in the United States. Therefore, in the last decade or so of his life, he was forced to retreat to highly prestigious institutions in Europe to conduct his research, eventually being captured in France in 1940 when the Germans invaded, and spending time in a prisoner of war camp before being allowed to return home to the United States, where he died shortly after. And I was struck by how similar this story was to that of another African-American scientist, Percy Julian, an organic chemist. Julian was raised in Alabama, but his parents sent him to DePaul University in Indiana, where he graduated valedictorian of his class. It was his dream to pursue a PhD, but was unable to do so because of a lack of teaching fellowships for African-Americans. He then moved to Fisk, another highly prestigious historically Black college at that time, where he was a chemistry instructor. After earning a master's degree in chemistry from Harvard, he moved to Howard as an instructor and then on to the University of Vienna, where he earned his PhD in chemistry. He returned to Howard University, where he became department head, but because of personal circumstances, he resigned from that position and returned to DePaul University, but only as an instructor in organic chemistry. And there he directed research projects for senior chemistry majors. At DePaul, he and a colleague from Vienna that he helped immigrate to the United States completed the total synthesis of physostigmine, a complex natural product used for the treatment of glaucoma. This achievement was recognized as a milestone in synthetic organic chemistry. Both he and his European colleague were offered jobs at DuPont, but his job was rescinded when he showed up because they didn't know he was Black. He was offered a job at the Institute of Paper Chemistry in Appleton, Wisconsin, but turned that down after finding out that Appleton was a sundown city where Blacks weren't allowed after dark. And he was finally able to secure a position at a company called Glidden, where he made impressive advances in the synthesis and isolation of steroid hormones and plant sterols before starting his company, which he sold for millions of dollars. He was an absolute pioneer in natural products, but couldn't get a professorship at a major research institution in the United States. And for his contributions to science, he was inducted into the National Academy of Sciences in 1973, only the second African-American scientist and first African-American chemist to have that distinction. And I could go on and tell a number of other similar stories, and for every story about an African-American who has been disenfranchised in science, there are unfortunately many more involving women. And if you look at the academic landscape today, you'll find that we're still trying to recover from the bigotry and misogyny of the past, some of which still exists, but we're sometimes afraid to make meaningful change. We still have highly acclaimed scientists, even Nobel Prize winners, who publicly proclaim that black people can't do science, and who make similarly disparaging comments about women. Statements like these have no value, and they dangerously creep unsuspectingly into the heads of decision makers. In 2008, 66 years after Ernest Just's death, I became the first African American to be on the faculty in the Department of Chemistry at Penn State. That it took so long is completely tragic. And many chemistry departments across the country are still waiting to get their first. But back in 1986, MIT gave me my first real opportunity to explore scientific research and realize my passion for discovery and for working with people from all over the world to solve problems. And the MIT chemistry department, and particularly my doctoral advisor, Joanne Stubbe, have been an ardent supporter ever since, helping me to achieve goals that I didn't even know existed when I first undertook this journey, or goals that I didn't even have for myself. I can honestly say that my cup runneth over today. So as I look out among you today, what I'll leave you with is the notion that almost anyone can excel if given a chance. Take advantage of opportunities and make the most of them, but also work to provide opportunities for others. That's how you will grow as a future leader. America's strength is its people, and there is so much untapped potential in people who have been traditionally disenfranchised, including people of color, women, the LGBTQ community, and the disabled. In fact, first-generation white students or students from modest socioeconomic backgrounds are the ones that I have impacted the greatest directly at Penn State. And you can't imagine how appreciative they have been to have been given a chance and some direction. Again, let me leave you with, I'm just an average guy from Southeast Texas, no different from anyone else, except for the fact that someone gave me an opportunity to make a change in the direction that I was going, and that has made all the difference. Thank you so much.